Okay. Thanks a lot for the introduction. As Anjam said, this is a joint work with Ivan, Jesper, and Mikael. So the talk is about secure multiparty computation introduced in the 80s by Yao et al. So secure multiparty computation allows a set of parties to jointly compute a joint function on the inputs in such a way that the honest parties receive the correct output, and the outputs are only the information leaked. Okay? And we want this to hold in the presence of an adversary who can arbitrarily corrupt the parties. And in our case, the adversary is going to be unbounded. We are in the information theoretic setting, semi-honest and static. Okay? And we also follow the idea-real paradigm. So we saw also the previous talks on secure multiparty computation, so I'm not going to give more details about this. So the motivating question is, like, what is the lower bound on the communication complexity of information theoretic protocols? And once we establish such a lower bound, the question is if we can show that these lower bounds are tight. So let me first start with the state of the art in the information theoretic protocols. So there are many information theoretic protocols that they work for both the honest majority setting and both for the dishonest majority setting with pre-processing. And without loss of generality, I'm going to split them into big categories. So the first category includes what we call the traditional secret sharing gate-by-gate protocols, okay, such as the GMW, the BGW, the CCD protocols. And these protocols work on secret share inputs, and they evaluate the circuit gate-by-gate. So initially, the inputs are secret shared, and then we follow the invariant that every time that we compute a gate, the outputs of that gate are like, we assume that it's a random secret sharing of the output. I'm going to be very specific about this in the next slide. So all the current protocols that we know in this model, they have to communicate per each multiplication gate. So the communication complexity is proportional to the circuit size C, where n is the number of parties. And actually, because of that, it follows that the run complexity grows with the multiplicative depth of the circuit. So now, if we give up being efficient in the circuit size of the evaluated function, we do have constant round, constant round protocols. For example, you can think of Yao in the information theoretic setting, where instead of implementing the symmetric encryption using crypto, we can use one-time PAD. But it's very easy to see that every time we go level by level, we will have to double the size of the one-time PAD. So that means that the complexity here is exponential in the depth. So these protocols are only efficient in the branching program size of the evaluated function. So they're only good for NC1 or log space computations. So this is the state of the art. And information theoretic protocols are great, especially the ones based on the secret sharing, because they're computationally more efficient than the tools that we use in the computational setting. For example, they're more efficient than fully homomorphic encryption. But they require a lot of interaction, right? So the big question is that if we can have a fully homomorphic encryption in the information theoretic setting, okay? And this question is very hard. And like, if you think about it, if we can prove that, then several breakthroughs will happen in different areas. So then maybe we can actually see if we can significantly improve the state of the art. And also, so we don't have any lower bounds for polysize information theoretic randomized encodings. Okay? We don't know if they exist. Moreover, we don't have any lower bounds for the gate-by-gate protocols. So let's tackle this problem and see if we can say something for gate-by-gate protocols. So there are all these open questions. And let's try to like dig into it and delve into the problem to see if we can say something and answer partially the question that I have on the bottom. Okay, so the question is that if we can significantly improve on that and prove that maybe we don't have to communicate per each multiplication gate, right? Or maybe we do have. So the answer is yes, we have to communicate per each multiplication gate. That's what we saw. And what does that mean is that actually it's a partial answer, and it shows that we have. So these are the only protocols that we know now, that they're efficient in the circuit size. So that means that we have to invent a completely new approach if we want to achieve the goal on the bottom. Okay, or even prove that that's impossible. Okay, so our result, so we prove that you have to communicate per each multiplication gate, and it trivially follows that the round complexity will be proportional to the multiplicative depth of the circuit. Yeah, and actually, we even saw that even if we're given preprocessing. And also, we also saw that we cannot have bounds that they grow with the field size. I will be very specific about this later as we go to talk. So let me be very specific about the model, and then I'll show you the impossibility results. So we are in synchronous point-to-port secure channels. We have n-party protocols, T out of n static corruptions, semi-honest security, statistical security. And actually, the weaker the assumptions, the stronger the impossibility results. Okay. So let's see how these gate-by-gate protocols work that we seem to be using all the time. So we have multiplication and addition gates. So at the beginning, we secret share the inputs. And at the end, we have an output secret sharing. Okay, so we have as an invariant, every time that we compute each gate, we have a multiplication gate protocol. And actually, because we work on secret shares, additions are for free. We don't, when I say for free, I mean that we don't need to communicate for additions, but we do have to communicate for multiplications. So let me emphasize what this multiplication protocol does. So since we said that we work on secret shares, so we secret share the inputs A and B. The bracket notation means secret sharing. Based on the secret sharing S with n players and the privacy threshold T. So we secret share the inputs. So now the multiplication gate protocol receives inputs which are secret shared. And then this outputs a secret sharing of A times B. And then correctness, we of course want to compute it correctly. And actually, the output secret sharing reveals only A times B, nothing else. Okay, so this is how these gate-by-gate protocols work. And also, we are interested in the communication in the red area. I don't care how much communication happens in the input secret sharing phase and in the output secret sharing phase, because that will not show me how much communication intensive is the valuation of the circuit. And also, there are many beautiful works lowering bandwidth communication, starting with the work with Kusilovich, and there's the recent work of Data, Pravakaran, and Pravakaran. But these protocols actually show lower bands for addition. But in our model, additions are for free. And also, these models consider clear inputs. Okay? Here, we start with inputs that they're secret shared. Okay? So we cannot really use techniques from these papers because we work on secret shared data, not on clear inputs, because we really want to see what is the communication complexity in the red area. Okay? So this is our lower bound in the honest majority setting. So we prove that the message complexity Paris multiplication gate is 2t plus 1. Basically, we have to communicate Paris multiplication gate. And we have this bound that the communication complexity doesn't grow with the size of the field. So also, we can have very nice circuits. Okay, so where we can do, so suppose that we have k multiplication, so if the circuit is nice and the number of players grows with k, then we can do all these k multiplications at once. And we can do that based on packed secret sharing, actually. But the question here is, okay, that works only if the number of parties grows with the number of multiplications, but what if you have constant number of parties? So, and actually we saw that if we have constant number of parties, it is actually indeed true that the communication complexity should grow linearly with k. And actually we saw that for a restricted class of secret sharing schemes, but it's good enough to include some secret sharing. We also proved something about the computational complexity. We proved that everybody has to work hard. You cannot save any computational works. For example, you cannot have lazy parties. They can do sublinear computation in K. So this proves for the K amortization that actually current methods based on packed secret sharing, they're optimal up to constant factors. Okay. So now for the previous results were for the honest majority setting. Now moving to the dishonest majority setting where we assume preprocessing, right? That's the only way that we can do dishonest majority in the information theoretic setting. So there we prove the following. So if the output sharing is additive, we prove that you have to communicate per its multiplication gate. And for arbitrary secret sharing schemes, we prove that an inner product gate has to communicate. Okay. And I'm going to start with a warm-up for the honest majority case. So here we prove that we have to communicate per its multiplication gate. So here I'm going to like simplify the proof. Oh, that's from there. Yeah, so I'm going to simplify the proof. And instead of showing you for 2t, I'm going to show you for t just to simplify the proof. So actually, this is like a warm-up, and it's very easy to see it. So let me start.
You're hitting it.
Okay. Okay, so suppose that we have a multiplication protocol which is too good and it doesn't communicate a lot, okay? So we want to prove that this is not possible. So for the proof, suppose that we do have such a protocol. So, and now I'm taking these parties, these T parties, that they communicate between each other, since I assume that they expect the communication complexity is at most T. And then I'm taking also another party. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to build a two-party protocol that, that computes the product. So I'm going to have two parties, Alice and Bob, and I'm going to construct a protocol that computes A times B. So how are we going to do that? Using the multiplication gate protocol. So party A is going to emulate all these T parties that they communicate between each other. And then party B is going to emulate the last party. And everything is going to happen in the head of Alice. So Mutu talked a lot about this. Everything happens in the head. Okay. So how are we going to do it? So at the beginning, party A and B, they secret share their inputs. And then together, they emulate the multiplication gate protocol here. Okay. So we emulate the protocol. And then at the end, we after the multiplication gate protocol, we receive the output shares. And then we just have to exchange them. So party, we send CT plus one to party A and C1 up to CT to the other party. And correctance trivially follows because Alice and Bob, they have exactly T plus one shares, so they can reconstruct. And privacy actually follows from the privacy of the multiplication gate protocol that we do in the middle here. And here, remember that there's no communication between here, so the communication was happening here between these T parties, but everything happens in Alice's head. Okay, so it's actually very easy to show that for one party, it's very easy to simulate the shares of the other party. So suppose that one party of the two is corrupted, either Alice or Bob. So we can actually simulate the shares received from the honest parties just from the shares of the malicious party, and the output A times B. And A times B comes from the output of the emulation of the multiplication gate protocol. And by assumption, the multiplication gate protocol reveals only A times B, so we can simulate. Okay, so that's the bound. So what did we build here? So where is the contradiction, all right? We need some contradiction. So I showed you a protocol, how we can do the product of A times B of two parties, okay? Using the multiplication gate protocol. But actually, if you think about it, we know that it's impossible to do two-party computation in the information theory setting from scratch. Okay, it's just impossible. We know it, it's very well known. But I showed you that I did it before. So here is where is the contradiction. Since we don't know how to do from scratch two-party computation. And before, I showed you that we did it here, actually. Also, here's something that I want to say is that, so, okay, we did it for the honest majority, and we reached the contradiction based on the fact that we don't know how to build two-party computation, right? So can we reach a contradiction in the same way also for the pre-processing phase, where we use pre-processed stuff? So the answer is no, right? Because we know how to do two-party computation when we have pre-processed data in the dishonest majority setting. So this argument completely breaks down in the pre-processing phase, if we have pre-processing phase. So we must find another way to reach a contradiction. So here is our result for the dishonest majority setting. So here I'm going to give you the main idea and the main difficulty of the proof. So here is that we saw that per its multiplication gate, the message complexity is at most n minus 1 in the preprocessing model, at least. So here, So the difficulty is the following. So before, we were emulating this multiplication gate protocol here, right? But now, this multiplication gate protocol uses preprocessed data. Plus, when we want to reconstruct, we will have to use some preprocessed data. Okay? So how we are able to solve that, the main difficulty is that now, given preprocessed data, we need to reach some contradiction. And actually, there's this result from Winkler and Wieslager in 2010 that they actually give lower bounds on the amount of preprocessed data that you need to compute any function. So you give me any function, and I tell you how much preprocessed data it needs exactly. So we will try to get the contradiction from here. So in high level, what we saw is that we are able, like while we're doing this reduction, we are able to reuse some preprocessed data when we have additive secret sharing. Okay, and we prove that we are able to reuse preprocessed data, and we are constructing a protocol that uses less preprocessed data than what the bound of Winkler and Wieslager says. Okay, and that's how we reach our contradiction. And also, if we consider arbitrary secret sharing, there are even more complications. Okay, that's the main difficulty. But what I would really like to show now is this thing I was talking about in the honest majority setting. If the message complexity, I showed you that we have to send 2t plus 1 messages for the honest majority case. But do these messages have to grow with the field size? Okay. So, and current protocols, actually, this is true for current protocols. We do, the communication complexity does depend on the field size. But actually, surprisingly, we saw that the answer is no. We can have some secret sharing that actually this is not true. And I'm going to give you the counter example now. So the counter example goes as follows. So suppose that we want to secret share the input A, which belongs to some field. And I'm going to represent it as Zi and Li in the following way. So if A is 0, I'm going to like set Za to be 0. If it's not 0, then I'm going to set it to 1. So now for the Li value, if A is 1, I'm going to like choose a random element in the multiplicative group of F. And if it is not, I'm going to take the logarithm of A based on some fixed generator of the multiplicative group. And now it's very easy to see that if you want to multiply, you will multiply Za times Zb, and you will add La and Lb. Okay, and you will take the modulo. So now let's see. So here was our multiplication gate protocol. So what are we going to do? So I show you how we represent our elements now. So now we're going to secret share Za and Zb using, for example, Samir. And then we also additively secret share La and Lb, okay, using some additive secret sharing. And now we give shares to the multiplication gate protocol because it works on shares. And then we're going to get the result out. Okay, so let's see what we did now. So actually, you can notice that when we multiply Za and Zb, these values are bits, right? So I can use any multiplication gate protocol that operates on bits. And the communication complexity of this protocol, because it operates on bits, it will be independent of the field size. And also, we said that we don't need communication for adding the shares, right, the LA and LB. So that clearly shows that the communication complexity can be independent of the size of the field. So you see here, I only needed to do a multiplication on bits. Okay, so that's the counter example. So we cannot have we cannot get a bound on the cross with the size of the field. The answer is no. So let me go now to conclusions and open problems. So actually, we saw that there were many open problems in the information theoretic setting, and we still have many open problems. And we actually tackle the protocols that we are using, like, and we know them. So the secret sharing gate-by-gate protocols, which are actually the only ones that they are efficient in the circuit size of the evaluated function. The ones based on randomized encodings, they are only efficient for the branching program size. And we saw lower bounds, showing that we cannot significantly improve protocols that fall in this category. We have to communicate Paris multiplication gate. So an obvious open question is if our lower bounds extend to any protocol, not just the secret chain gate-by-gate protocols, which we're the only ones that actually know. That's why I said before, that means that we completely have to do, to construct completely new approaches to do information theoretic protocols if we want to achieve this, even if it's possible, right? Maybe it's not possible. And as I said, it will mean many, it will imply many breakthroughs in many areas. Okay, also something that I wanted to say, here we don't assume anything about the, we don't assume that the secret sharings are the same. They can be different. We only assume that the threshold secret sharing, the privacy threshold for the honest majority case is like at least 2t, and for the dishonest majority case it's just n. Also, I don't make any assumption on the multiplication gate protocols. Maybe my circuit uses different multiplication protocols. Okay. So now another obvious question is that what we know is that what we assume is that we the output secret sharing doesn't reveal anything else, only A times B. Okay. And this is what we do in all the current protocols, and this is for what we solve our bounds. So an obvious question is, if we can actually, for the intermediate gates, okay, of the circuit, we can actually be more relaxed, and maybe we can allow this distribution of shares to have some traces of the inputs. Why? Because in the intermediate gates, maybe I don't have to communicate, maybe I don't have to reveal information. I only need this property for the final gate of the circuit. In the final gate, I want to reveal only A times B. But in the intermediate gates, maybe we can do something. And that concludes my talk.